Right, and let's jump into this in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Hi guys, and welcome to Piano and Keyboard Artist, where we discuss the artists related to pianos, keyboards, and synthesizers. And this is part 3 of my mini-series, which I'm calling 40 Years of Depeche Mode. And in this episode, I thought we'd do something different. Now, I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 guests on today. And these are all people that I've met through the common theme being Depeche Mode. And I'm going to introduce them all. The whole idea of this chat is to just have a chat with some really hardcore, interesting Depeche Mode fans. And we're just going to flow with it from there. So kicking off, let's start with you, Atusa. Please introduce yourself and tell us how you got into Depeche Mode.
Oh, okay. My name is Atusa. I currently live in Los Angeles, California. You could also find me in San Francisco and London, but I'm trapped here right now. But I got into Depeche Mode in a really strange way. I was 10 or 11 years old, and my cousin had the full cassette of Depeche Mode 101. So my real full introduction to them was a live concert, audio only. And so the first time I listened to it, I was in love. It was a live show and this guy was yelling and thank you and all these, the sounds of the crowd, and you can hear kind of like where they were moving on stage depending on where the crowd would cheer. And I thought, whatever this is, I want this. I bought all the albums that they had and I was just addicted. Absolutely.
Wow. So yeah, so interesting. You got into it on 101, which was, I love hearing how people were introduced to it. Right. Mike, let's have your story, sir. Introduce yourself and tell us how you got into Depeche Mode.
Yeah. So I'm Mike, as you said, and let's see, I first heard Depeche in 85. I was 14 at the time. You know, people are people. I grew up in the LA area, Orange County specifically, and heard People Are People and then Some Great Reward, and that led to the singles, and all within a very short amount of time. And then freshman year of high school, Black Celebration came out, and it was, you know, all in from there. That's kind of the short version. Yeah.
That's great. Well, we're going to have a lot of time to elaborate. Let's have a word with a new boy. It's David McElroy. We've met for the first time tonight. David, you run a Depeche Mode blog called Almost Predictable. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right. It's the full name's Almost Predictable, almost after the line and get the balance right.
Yeah.
I started that a few years ago. Mainly because I needed somebody to talk to about Depeche Mode, and I'd bored all my friends, so I thought the world could listen instead. And it's become it's become far bigger a thing than I ever thought it would be. And it's good fun, and it's introduced me to many Depeche Mode fans around the world, including everybody here. And it's been, I like to think, it's been a success, yeah.
Well, this is the great thing about the internet. I've spoken about this on many of my videos, that in school, there were only a few people that liked Depeche Mode because it is such an acquired taste. And the wonderful thing about the internet and this community and the, you know, the adjoining communities like Depeche Mode Global, which we're going to get to now, have helped us all connect. And on the subject of Depeche Mode Global, I would like to introduce, he needs no introduction, he is Mr. Rob Rom, who we call Up the Ante Rob. Because whatever you do, he's done it better. Rob, please introduce yourself, my friend.
Hi, everyone. My name is Rob, as Von George said, and I've been a fan for 35 of the 40 years that Depeche Mode has been around. Similar to Mike, I'm slightly older. Basically, I was in ninth grade and in middle school. My middle school was 7th, 8th, and 9th grade. So I got into Depeche Mode when I heard People Are People, and Master and Servant. Then Shake the Disease came out, and basically all that stuff was played at my middle school graduation. So after that, everything was on. My first time seeing them was July 13th, 1986 on the Black Celebration Tour at the Forum in Los Angeles. And once I did that, I was hooked. I went back-to-back nights, actually, to Irvine Meadows in Orange County as well. And fast forward to 2020, and the Depeche Mode Global Fan Group has been around now for 3 years. We've been doing all kinds of virtual events. I started the group after I hosted Depeche Mode's Facebook page. I was day 114. And I'm also doing a radio show every Monday on Reflex Radio called Mode Block.
Absolutely. Rob, thanks for being on here tonight, mate. And Depeche Mode Global really is, as far as I'm concerned, the premier Facebook group when it comes to Depeche Mode. There are quite a few out there. There are some that are doing really well. I also want to make a special shout out tonight to the Depeche Mode Peru Facebook group, to Marisol, who's doing a fantastic job there, and also to my locals here, Rob, not to be confused with Rob Rom from Depeche Mode Global, but Rob and Dobbo from Depeche Mode UK Facebook group, who are also doing really, really great work. So we're becoming like we're all joining forces, and the common goal is Depeche Mode, and that's going to come on to the first question. But before I get onto that first question, guys, the first question is going to really be 40 years of Depeche Mode. Why are we still talking about this band after 40 years? But before we get to that question, I just want to ask you, anyone here, I'm sure you have heard the new Martin Gore record. Any comments or anything you'd like to say?
I'm a big fan.
Go ahead, David. Go ahead.
Sorry. Yeah. Well, I'm a big fan. I liked his MG album. I was a big fan of the Counterfeit albums as well, but I really liked the MG album because it was something different. And I think this new single's really taken it on. It reminds me quite a bit of Nine Inch Nails and their Ghosts work as well, which I quite enjoy. So it's something different. I'd like to see Depeche Mode be a bit more experimental like this on an album track or two, more so. I think they've done it once on My Little Universe.
Sure.
That was the only kind of out-and-out techno track they've released. So I'd like to see more of this. I'd be keen. So I'm very keen to hear the EP.
Absolutely. Rob, you were saying?
Oh, yeah, I agree. I enjoyed it as well. And I think it does have a little more of that industrial tinge, like David mentioned with the Nine Inch Nails kind of sound. It seems like a little bit like a progression from MG, just a little slightly more industrial sounding. But definitely happy to get anything that we can get from Martin and or any of the band members. So definitely appreciative to hear new music from them.
Yeah, I heard the track, and I really liked it. I know obviously people have opinions. There are some people that are saying they don't like it and you know whatnot. I personally really liked what I heard. You know, this is definitely Martin going on his own trip. The only disappointment, and it's not disappointment in a negative way, I just really thought we were going to get like a Martin Gore vocal album. Because let's face it, when Martin Gore's not singing, that's one of his biggest assets. So to me, when Martin releases a instrumental album, it's kind of like a boxer going into the ring with his right hand tied behind his back. And I mean, no disrespect by that. It's just that Martin is he's the man with a golden voice. So glad to, as you guys say, I'm so glad we've got something, but I just love the man's voice. And I just think on every Depeche Mode record, he only gets two songs. I'm thinking I'd like to hear more Martin vocals. You know what I mean? Personally.
I thought it was great. But then again, I'm somebody who kind of grew up listening to things like Autechre and Future Sound of London. So I like that kind of thing. To me, I can relate to it because I feel like he just put out all the things that he's really strong at doing in his part of recording inside of Depeche Mode songs. So all the electronic stuff, all the analog synths that you kind of hear in the background, you pull all that out and you put it all into this one like mandrel and it's just, it's all there.
Yeah, he is a master of making melody without playing melodies, because if you know what I mean, because this isn't very melodic, but just by using the modulars, a lot of melody is suggested. And yeah, I really, really like what we're hearing. Really like, but I love his voice and I'd love to have heard his voice. Mike, what did you think?
Kind of the same as you. It was, I kind of, I tried to let go of any expectations as to what it was going to be and just tried to wait for it. And the thing I found really interesting was if you close your eyes and just listen to it, put the headphones on, it paints a lot of pictures.
Yeah.
Like you could really, you know, let your imagination fly with it. And you wouldn't get that if you had lyrics.
Correct.
Well, you would, but you know, they would be guided.
You're absolutely right, Mike. And it's kind of like when you listen to music from a foreign language and you don't understand the lyrics, you tend to focus more on the tune and the melody and stuff because you're not sort of not say misled, but you're not following the words. So it does. I think it does stimulate a different part of your brain, which I find a more visual part of the brain kicks in because you start to visualize things, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm a very much music first listener anyway. Like the lyrics, I always have to go back and read, and in order for them to really sink in and understand what they are, I'm always, you know, music and melody.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I'm always on about melody. So yeah, so Martin Gore's new track, I'm looking really forward to, you know, I'll probably get it on vinyl. I was talking to Gareth yesterday, Gareth Jones. God, that sounds like such names dropping, doesn't it? But
it's your first name.
And, and then it sounded like he was that names dropping because he was like, yeah, he was like, I was just on the phone to Daniel earlier on. And I said, Gareth, are you names dropping? Yeah, because he was on the phone. And I was like, Daniel, who? Oh, Daniel. And I just, then I had this surreal thing going like, is this really happening? Am I really speaking to these people? But anyway, right. So let's get on to the first question I was going to ask you guys. And it was the topic of the first video I released in my 40 years of Depeche Mode miniseries. And that episode was entitled 40 years of Depeche Mode. And the question was, what is it about this band? Because there are so many bands now that started at that time. They're not around anymore. Once again, by making a comparison now, I mean no disrespect, but Ultravox, for instance, were massive back in the time when Depeche Mode came out, and they're not sort of, they certainly don't have this sort of absolute, they do have a cult-like following, but Depeche Mode are just something else. You know, for a band that has been going for 40 years, I think Depeche Mode really have that kind of like Rolling Stones kind of iconic. People are obsessed with them. And this is the question I'm going to start off with you, Atusa. Why do you think after 40 years, we still have this band, they're bigger than ever, and you know their popularity is not waning?
More than ever. And after Rob and I took, we participated in that Depeche Mode 365 takeover thing. Because and David too, because we were doing that, and we were really focused in on meeting other people who were chosen for it. You really get the sense that you're not the only one who has this really close attachment to. It could be every song that they have. It something about them sticks with you and. Almost can determine, you can listen to a song and know where you were, how old you were when you heard it, what experiences you went through. And it's that kind of thing that I think Depeche Mode somehow, more than any other band, can create that really good bond. And a lot of times when I was reading the stories of the takeovers, I was thinking, I actually thought I was the biggest fan. Depeche Mode fan there was, but no, these other people know what it feels like to have this bond. And I think that bond with the sound, with all the members themselves, like your love for them and your appreciation for what you do, I think that is more different than any other band that I've ever experienced. I don't only listen to Depeche Mode, I listen to thousands of bands.
Of course.
But I don't have that connection that I have with Depeche Mode, and I think everyone else that's like us has that bond as well.
Absolutely. And I just think with my channel, you know, when I do videos, I don't sort of, a lot of the stuff is just off the fly. And a lot of the stuff like the Martin Gore love and, you know, the off topic chickens and the Alan Wilder fan, that is all just quite spontaneously And these are becoming like sayings within the community now. And it is really inspired by, you know, it's very difficult to sometimes explain why we feel the way we do, but that's what's so great about these communities is that, you know, I've met my tribe and I've met people who are as crazy as I am and on the same wavelength. Rob, what are your feelings on the question, my friend?
So realistically, when you look at their music, it's very deep and personal. So a lot of people, you know, there's someone that had shared a sign that became viral at one of the concerts where it showed Martin, you wrote the soundtrack to my life. And I think many of us feel that way. I mean, especially, you know, like I said, 35, next week I turn 50. So 35 of my 50 years, I've been a Depeche Mode fan and a hardcore Depeche Mode fan in that entire time. So, and beyond that, they have a futuristic sound, which if you listen to the music from back in the 80s, the production level is so good that it sounds like it could be released now. I mean, things like Master and Servant. And then you have that chemistry that, you have that rare chemistry, Dave and Martin, RDM, Dave and Martin. It's like Lennon and McCartney, Jagger and Richards.
Yeah.
You know, you don't always get that sort of chemistry. And the live performance that they put on takes them to another level beyond, you know, Duran was huge in the days back in the 80s, whatever. But Depeche Mode, I feel like, has a better stage presence, even though they don't have as many, like, sure, John Taylor's an amazing bass player. And but just the performance, the energy that Dave Vaughn exudes on stage just takes them to another level.
Sure.
It's a rare quality to have.
Yeah. Mike?
I think, like both Robin and Atusa have articulated it, Martin is beyond just a lyricist or a poet that puts that to music. He speaks to the human psyche, which I think is why we all have connected so deeply with these things in our own ways. And I think that's the sort of the core behind the longevity is, you know, I think you've mentioned on your thing that, you know, you can strip away all the electronics and everything and the core is still there. It's still an amazing song with amazing words that speaks right to you. And I think just the time period that we were all part of with the electronics evolving and it was new, like Rob said, it's futuristic, but it's also timeless at the same time. Like, you know, because it's not based on any particular types of sounds and every album kind of evolves from the previous one. And so it's not like every time they come out with something, it's something new that we really haven't heard before.
Yeah, really, it really is. And as you said there, Mike, I'm always pointing out on the, you know, on the reviews I do of their music is there are a lot of gimmicks and smoke and mirrors in, you know, in every art or thing. But with Depeche Mode, that's why I always do these piano improvisations and I drum on it a lot, is you pull, you know, a lot of people might just think, oh, it's fat. You know, people who aren't fans will think, oh, it's fancy production, it's style, it's all this. When you pull all of that away and you just play it on the piano, you've got some really, really stunning stuff there. And I've demonstrated that many, many times. And they are not a one-trick pony. There are so many layers to it. David, what are your thoughts, my friend?
I think firstly, it's their innovation. Every album they released, is different. But if you look at really from A Broken Frame to Songs of Faith and Devotion, they could easily be different albums by different bands because the leap they took every single time was extraordinary.
Yeah.
I mean, you think of what they were doing, say, with Construction Time again, especially in Britain, they were still very much a pop band who people just didn't really pay much attention to in the mainstream. Yet they still had top 10 hits. And these were top 10 hits that were laced with industrial sampling. They were using found sounds. They were just breaking down barriers that no other band came near. And if you look at their contemporaries, Rob mentioned Duran Duran. I must confess to not being a Duran Duran fan in any sense whatsoever, but I think any of Depeche Mode's contemporaries, or really all of Depeche Mode's contemporaries, have fallen by the wayside, and they rely now more on retreading past glories rather than innovating. Now, the last Depeche Mode tour, which we all saw too many concerts, yes, there was a kind of greatest hits element towards the second half of that show, but still, they open up with two new songs from the new album in a stadium in the middle of Europe somewhere. It's a very brave move. They're still innovating. They're still pushing boundaries. And I think the live performance is another key. We've all mentioned that Depeche Mode, we're all touched by Depeche Mode in different ways, but there are very few bands and very few songwriters who can write a song that means something incredibly special to you as an individual that you can feel when you're listening to in your bedroom, and you can also feel when you're standing with 60,000 other people at the Olympic Stadium in London. They're just masters of, I guess, putting emotion in a song, and really just they just Martin's just a genius. It's a very kind of biased way of describing it, but he is, and that genius and that songwriting genius that's carried them through.
And he's a very unassuming genius. You know, he's just it's quite funny if you listened to the music. And you said to someone, suddenly someone had never listened to Depeche Mode, and you said, okay, go listen to this music. And then all they heard was the music. And you say, okay, now describe to me what you think this songwriter looks like. And they'd probably think, you know, it'd be someone with jet black hair and covered with tattoos and very like dark and gothic. And in comes this candy floss hair, you know, he's a really sweet looking guy. He always has been really like sweet and wholesome looking. And he's got this really geeky laugh. So I just love it. I just love that. There's nothing sort of contrived about them. You know, they were never trying to be dark or weird. Everything just flowed. And when you see a lot of these kind of knockoff acts where people are trying to copy them, you hear these guys singing in a deep voice when their voice isn't actually deep. And there was nothing contrived about Depeche Mode. And I can go on and on and on. But thanks, guys, for your feelings are very much like, you know, I think we'll feel the same. But now I want to get on to that saying where they say, never, ever meet your heroes. But I think everyone within this group here has an interesting story to tell. I think Atusa's blushing the most there, but we'll leave her for last. The interesting story, Atusa. You know, the interesting one, yeah. So we're going to start. We're going to start off with Mike and Rob. Now, Mike and Rob, you two have been friends for many, many years. School friends, is that right?
Mm-mm. Oh yeah, we actually met because of David.
Okay.
This is a pretty interesting story, actually. The fact that I'm a big baseball fan. Mike's a baseball fan. Which, how would this connect with David, right? So. David retweeted something where Mike caught a home run ball. The Angels were playing the Mariners. So I'm from the Anaheim area and Mike is in Seattle. And I was wondering, why is this guy in UK, the Depeche Mode guy, retweeting a baseball play? Like, what is going on here? So I had to look into it. And I looked at Mike's profile, and there were so many similarities that I had to reach out to him. And that's how we started talking. So.
But you two were actually at the 101 concert at the Rose Bowl Pasadena on June 18th, 1988. You guys were actually there. Is that right?
That's correct. But we were not there together. But we were both there at the venue.
We were about as far apart as you can get. He was in the front. I was way in the back.
I see. Tell us what was, I mean, we are talking many, many years ago, but was that sort of like the biggest thing you'd experienced as far as a live show was at that stage of your life? Was that like mind-blowing?
For me, that was my third concert ever of at least artists that I wanted to go see.
Yeah.
I'd seen them, seven months before that at the same date with Rob, of course, different seats, at the Forum. And it's hard to say that we kind of knew at the time how iconic that was going to be. You know, it was a big, a gigantic stadium show with a whole bunch of artists that we like. That was, you know, I was 17. It grew into something much bigger than we knew it was huge, but you know, as a teenager, and you know, it didn't really kind of sink in until like at least the next tour and when the video came out and so on.
Yeah. Then you were happy to know that you were actually a part of that. So that's wonderful. Mike, have you met any of the band members personally?
I have. Not too many times. I was able to get backstage in 94.
You met Alan Wilder, did you? I saw a photo with you.
Yeah, so that was later. I met Alan in 2010 when he was doing his Recoil tour.
I got you.
Actually, I did meet him that day as well, but it was very brief. The fun story about that experience was it was my birthday. My friend managed to get us backstage, and we got there. We went back there right away, and nobody was out there. It was just like the bartender and some people milling around. So we walked up to the foosball table, started playing each other, got a drink, and then people started to fill in the little patio thing, and I look up and Martin and his bodyguard Andre walk right up behind my friend and say, "Hey, do you mind if we jump in?" And what am I going to say? No. And so my buddy came to the other side and we, you know, played foosball with Martin for, I don't know, probably about 10 minutes. They kicked the crap out of us because we were very distracted.
Yeah, I'm sure.
I've not met Dave and I've not met Andy. Andy was on his leave for that leg of that tour. So, yep, on my list.
Rob, you've met Martin several times because you live in California, and so does Rob. And I think Rob is up the ante, yeah, because I think Martin actually bought you a drink, didn't he?
Yeah, that's correct. 2004, I ran into him at David Bowie's concert in Los Angeles.
Okay. And
the funny thing was, is I kept waiting to go to the restroom because Bowie kept playing great songs, and I'm like, all right, I can't wait any longer. I just have to go. So I went, and walking out, I looked to my left, and Martin's right there, and I'm like, I started talking to him, and then I said, "Hey, do you want to get a beer?" And he's like, "Sure." And I was expecting I was going to buy him a beer. You know, I would love to. It'd be an honor to buy Martin Gore a beer, right? And I said that, and he's like, no, I'll get you a beer. And then I thought about it, and I thought, well, I've bought enough Depeche Mode stuff. I definitely
True.
So he bought me a big Corona Bomber, which is like a 24-ounce beer, which is basically like two beers in America. So, and we actually stood out in the lobby drinking for about 20 minutes while Bowie is playing. And he's a huge Bowie fan, and I like Bowie, but if I'm gonna hang out with Martin Gore, I'll miss the Bowie concert. I'm okay with that.
Was he there alone? Was he there by himself?
No, he was there with a friend of his who actually had, because later I asked him, "How are my seats better than yours?" And he had got the tickets from his friend as a Christmas gift. So not that his seats were bad, but I just was surprised that my seats were actually better than Martin Gore's. You know, why would that happen? But,
I see.
But we were speaking in the lobby for like I said, 20 minutes. And I mean, we were talking about everything from karaoke, Elvis Presley. And he was so giddy about going backstage. It was like, I would be excited, or any of you would be excited to go backstage at the Depeche Mode concert. And he had mentioned that Bowie had heard, like he did a cover of one of his songs, and that Bowie had heard it before, and he had mentioned to him and liked it, and so he was thrilled about that, and it was just an amazing. So definitely, Martin Gore is a hero you want to meet. He's a great guy.
Oh, I see. Well, that's great. You guys know my story. You guys can watch the video. How I met Martin Gore. I was working in a music retail store in here in London, and he. there was no sort of warning. He just kind of walked in, and I freaked out. And yeah, anyway, the video's online, and it's when I made that video, I was a bit like, like with a lot of my videos, I'm like, do I do this? I usually hit the send button and just send, but I'm happy to say, that video was very well received. A very surreal experience. David, you had any meetings with the band members?
I haven't, I'm afraid. No, I've not met any of them yet. Oh. They've probably read the blog and probably want to stay away from me, to be honest. so I've not had a chance to chat to them. I did meet Bobby Gillespie of Primal Scream in a bar in Glasgow a few years ago and asked him about the exotic USA tour that they supported Depeche on in 94, but Bobby couldn't remember a lot about it, but he had a very good time and wasn't really prepared to go much further than that, but that's fair enough.
Right, well, Atusa, you've got an interesting story. We saved the best for last.
I don't know which one to tell.
There's another one, is there?
There's quite a few. I've met all of the band and I've got different stories, but I could tell my favorite.
We'll have to get you on another episode then. tell us the story when you went to, you and I were probably at the same gig though, because if I can remember correctly, you were at the Martin Gore's Counterfeit 2 gig. Was that in 2004? Was it at the Astoria in London?
No, I went to the Los Angeles Mayan one. That's where my story comes.
And you fancied his sound man or something like that. Go on, tell us the story. In your own words, in your own tongue.
I did. I fancied, oh gosh, it's so embarrassing. Yes, I did fancy him. And I went to the first night and Martin's, his click track went out. And so you could tell he was a little bit flustered. And so for night two, I thought I'll make him a really big sign, like a cute in support sign that said, "Martin, click, 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 we're here for you." Because we were all in the front. We were camping out at like 3 a.m. Even though we had tickets, it was general admission. We got there at 3 or 4 a.m. and sat there. But we made that sign, "Martin, click, 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 we're here for you." But I also thought, well, I like his producer. He's going to be on stage. So I made a sign that said, "Philpott, so hot." His name was Andrew Philpott. Oh, yeah. So I made this huge sign. I did the Martin click, 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 and Martin gave us the thumbs up. He loved it. But when I took out the "Philpott, so hot" during Surrender, Martin looked at it, and I have pictures of it. His eyes just, they were this big. He came down and took the sign and started waving it around while he was singing Surrender. And he kept the sign. And I thought, that was cool. There's tons of videos of it on YouTube. But after the show, my best friend, she was like, "Well, I know where they're going after the show. Let's go and see if we can get an autograph." I said, okay, not really my thing. I don't really like doing that kind of thing. But I thought, okay, you know what? She's a huge Martin Gore fan. Let's go. So we go. And right when we pull up to where they were, Martin's standing outside and she goes, "Get out of the car. Just go and get an autograph. Get out of the car." And I'm like, okay. So I get out of the car to go and get the autograph. And as I'm walking up to him, really nervous, he goes, "You're the Philpott So Hot girl." And I go, "I am." And he goes, "I want you and your friend to come to my after party. You made our night. Come to our after party." So his assistant gave us these little wristbands. And we ended up going and hanging out with them all night. And we ended up becoming friends. All of us became friends. I became really good friends with Philpott. They told me actually that they had the "Philpott So Hot" sign framed and put on the wall, kind of like as a joke for Philpott. But it ended up being amazing. It was like an all-nighter, so fun, singing with Martin, just amazing.
And I know people have told me on my videos when I say Martin's quite a shy guy, they go, "Vaughn, he's not shy." He's really not shy. I think he's just a very introverted, private person. I think he's one of those people, he's what you call a, I was always a bit like that, and I know a lot of people are like that. You're a, what do you call it? A social ext- a social introvert. You know, you're kind of, when you walk down the street, you're not the kind of person who shouts and draws attention to yourself. But when you're around people that you like, hence my channel and this, you can give the illusion that you're a real sort of like extrovert when in fact you're not. So I think Martin is that kind of person. But yeah, so you've got other stories to tell. Well, that's interesting. Well, I say I'm trying to keep my channel PG-13.
So. It might have to be like a Vaughn George After Dark or something.
I think we'll do it.
Vaughn George After Dark with a Tusa.
With special guest Stephen Hawking.
Okay, so Rob, you're kind of like yes. Some I get lots of you know, messages and emails, you know, every day really, and people often always ask me, you know, where's Alan or where's this or where's this, and then I really want to say, don't ask me, ask Rob Rom. He's the Depeche Mode Hub guy. But really, a question to you guys. Are we due a new album next year? Does anyone have sort of any inside information? Mike?
I'm going to default that to Rob.
Rob?
So there have been a couple of sources that said that the band are working on songs for a new album. First off, Richard Blade, the American, well, he's actually from England, but He was very popular in Los Angeles, and he has a national radio show on Sirius XM. He has stated that the band were in the studio recording and planning a tour, which turned into a whole crazy discussion in Global. But anyway, I do believe that the band is writing and working on new songs, whether it be in their own personal studios, as Peter Gordano has also mentioned in a Zoom on with Peru. So I'm fairly confident that they're working on new music, but at what point they are, I have no idea. I'm sure we'll find out next week when Martin's interviewed on, there's a show that he's going to be on in the UK, I believe.
Yeah.
Next, the 28th or something like that.
Yes. Now I do think we're due another album because it's usually every 4 years, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Because, you know, they just don't do everything, you know. A lot of bands do like these tours every year and stuff, but because of the Depeche Mode, it's just because of the scale. If you think of the scale, like, I mean, even like the last tour, the scale was massive, you know, it was an album. And then I think they toured that album for, what was it? Nearly 2 years. It was like 18 months. It was a year and a half. It was a long tour. You know, you've got like 2 years on the road. And then of course you've got to, you know, get back and live a bit. But I suppose, it, you know, it's not a bad life. I don't
Did we lose Vaughn George?
Oh,
you froze up there for a minute. But
oh, did I freeze up? Oh, yeah. I just thought you were all ignoring me. It was like an awkward silence. I was like,
not this time.
Not this time, yeah. Now, I just said the last tour as well was, you know, it was massive. It was like a stadium tour. And you think of it, there's the writing process. So, you know, the whole making of the album's probably like a year process, you know, everything from the, you know, the planning to the execution and the pre-production and the, you know, the press, that's about a year. And then of course, then you're on the road for a year and a half. It's not a bad life, but here's a question. How much longer do you think we're going to have them? And I don't mean that in a, like they're going to die kind of way, but how much mileage do you think is left in Depeche Mode?
I would never underestimate them. I started thinking on the Exciter tour that this might be the last time I was going to see them. And I thought that a couple times, like that time and playing the Angel. Then after that, I just was like, oh, they're going to keep coming on. I'm not even going to bother trying to figure out if this is the last time I'm going to see them. I'm just going to enjoy every time that I see them and make sure I have a great time. But, I mean, who would have thought that I saw the Rolling Stones last year and Mick Jagger's like 70 something years old and he looks like phenomenal. It's just amazing. So yeah, maybe Depeche Mode becomes the Rolling Stones of synthesizers. I don't know, but
yeah. Yeah. I was talking when Gareth had a very interesting way of putting it. I love speaking to him. He's very philosophical. He's a little bit like Yoda in a way, quite a guru. And he always does this kind of thing. Very insightful. And I was talking about how you know, many years ago, when you were 25 years old, you know, it was game over because it was pop. That was pop. But now, Gareth said, because rock and roll is as an art form, it's fundamentally quite a young art form still, because rock and roll only started in the 60s. And because those artists are still around and they're getting older, it's becoming more acceptable now that we, you know, we accept older artists, if you know what I mean. And also, I think as an older artist, I think, you know, your writing and your life experience is so much better. I just think the whole, and we don't want to talk about pop, but with pop music, this whole idea with, you know, you're 30, you're washed up now, you've got to resign. You know, when you get these singer-songwriters that are 17 years old, and I don't want to be condescending, it's just like, how much life experience have you got compared to someone in their 60s? You know, I was listening to Billy Joel the other day playing the piano, and I thought, wow, man. You know, his songs have been readapted. He doesn't sing as high as he used to, so everything's kind of transposed. But what he lacks in range, he's got like this real sort of grit and this like, it's like well-stewed. It's just, there's like a maturity and an essence that can only come with age. And I'm going off on a tangent now, so let me have another.
Well, one more point about, I would say that Dave had as much energy on the last tour as I had ever seen at any point since 1986. I mean,
yeah,
they did take a day off between each gig, but still, he had that energy. It was crazy.
Yeah, they've all stopped. They're all very clean living now, aren't they? Because, I mean, they're all elk. I think Fletch still drinks, but Martin and Dave are completely teetotaler now, aren't they?
Yes.
I believe that Dave does a lot of running now. Apparently, he's like obsessed with like running, because that's one of the things I believe. If you're an alcoholic or an addict or something, you need to put your attention onto something else. And apparently, he's very obsessed about running and keeping fit, and he looks fantastic. So, and speaking about the beers, Rob, you haven't got any beers there today. What's your record on the Depeche Mode Global? Was
that? And actually, since you guys had a drink, I cracked the beer open after all. But I'm not sure my record, but I've definitely had 20 something beers over a long time period. But again, we've been on these Depeche Mode drinking chats for sometimes 15 hours, which is insane, right? But David, you'll have to join us one of these times when you wake up in the UK, or one of the ones when we have an earlier start time.
Yeah,
that'll be good.
One tomorrow, yeah.
Yeah, we're doing it later just because I knew you had an event going earlier on, so I didn't want to conflict with that. So
bless you, sir. It's like the Clash of the Titans, Rob. We've got to make sure what each other are doing. So, and by the way, Rob's going to come on, as I say, tomorrow. He's going to be my wingman. It's going to be a very interesting chat. We're interviewing. It's a Q&A with David Brooks, the keyboard player from Gary Newman's keyboardist, and people are going to come in and ask questions. Right, so back onto Depeche Mode. Right, so we've heard they're in the studio. Well, something that I've noticed about this band, and this is goes back all the years, is they're very private individuals. They seem to do more interviews now than they used to. I found in the earlier days, I think Martin especially, and then Martin was very shy. But I think these days they do a lot more interviews, but they only do interviews while they're touring. As soon as they finish touring, you never hear anything from them. They're very, very private. They're not these, you know, these attention-seeking celebrities that we see. Anyone care to elaborate on that?
I think that adds to the mystique about the band. Yeah. So it helps. I think that just fuels the passion of the fans, actually. It helps in that way.
Yeah, I mean, it was really, I'm thinking of reality TV. The real sort of first rock star, or I'm thinking of, did you remember Meet the Osbournes with Ozzy Osbourne and Sharon Osbourne? That was the very first that I can remember, like reality show where... A reality show where you go into someone's house. But there are elements of that now. I even think of like Gary Newman. You guys know I'm a huge Gary Newman fan, and Gary Newman was, when he came out in the beginning, he was always very mysterious, and his music is still mysterious, but because he's now doing what a lot of people are doing, having to promote themselves, it takes away a lot of the mysteriousness. You know, it's like, oh, I'm at home with my kids now and stuff. And whereas before, you would just imagine him as this android-like man, or what's he doing? Is he flying in a plane kind of thing? So, you know, there are pros and cons to the, as someone said the other day, one of their rock stars were like, yeah, I'm just in Starbucks having a latte. It's like, I don't want to know that, mate, you know?
Yeah, I think as a culture, we've gotten accustomed to getting information immediately and wanting information immediately, you know, like even with movies and you name it. And because of that, the sort of internet celebrity, I think sometimes we expect everybody to be like that. And I totally agree with you. There is a, you know, like almost a mythology about Depeche Mode, where, you know, it's more fun. Mystery is more fun than knowing all the answers all the time.
Correct. Absolutely. David, you were talking earlier on about how they kept changing their approach. And this is something I've spoken a lot on my videos, is how, if you look at a lot of bands, bands that have been going for a long time, they start out and they stumble and they fall. Even David Bowie, who's an absolute icon, you know, he got it wrong sometimes, but he kept evolving and, you know, he was the ultimate chameleon. But if we look at Depeche Mode, there was this awkwardness in the beginning, around about sort of, I think, of Shake the Disease. And a little bit before that, that's where they really sort of found themselves. It's only when I lose myself with someone else that I find myself. Sorry, got to remind myself, this is life. So what I'm saying is, so they really were always against the grain. They were always trying to prove themselves. They were always being slagged off and never taken seriously. But with that, they always changed, as you said, David, they changed their approach. They changed every album. And I just think one of the most dangerous things they did, and this is, I said in my series, the importance of Daniel Miller, was Daniel obviously had signed them, but he allowed them this freedom. And I also talked that if Depeche Mode had signed to a major label, they wouldn't have gotten past the third album because they would have been dropped. But Daniel allowed them to put out Black Celebration, which was very risky because it was a concept album. Fast forward to now, it's one of the best albums, I think we'll all agree. But by the time they got to Violator, this was really, I think they were in their early 30s. You know, this was like, they really sort of peaked. This is like, yeah, they got completely comfortable. They'd really found this new dark sound. So people could, a lot of people in the community cite Violator as the definitive album. Now, let's say they've gotten to that point. This is the definitive album. Most artists don't get to that level, but anyone who would get to that level would go, okay, we've got the formula now. We'll do Violator 1, Violator 2, Violator, you know, you would just repeat the formula. So what I think was so brave, you get to Violator, which is groundbreaking in every way. And then you think, okay, we're going to change it again. So I really think that, I've said this before, that Songs of Faith and Devotion was such a risky album to do. Because think, you get the success of Violator. Daniel could have turned around and gone, okay, now look, this is where we go from here. So I'm just wondering what you guys think of that decision to, you know, do you think it was dangerous? Do you agree? Do you disagree? Mike.
I think, Mike.
Actually, no, you were talking to David.
David, go for it.
It was a brave move, but it's not a surprise in many ways if you look at the albums that preceded it, because
yeah.
Black Celebration was this dark slab of, well, this gloriousness that that changed the perception of the band.
Yeah.
Music for the Masses was then quite despite the singles, it's quite a downbeat album throughout, and yeah. Yet that album took them into the stadiums in America.
Yeah.
Violator's then a complete change again, because you go for this electronic blues for the first time that they properly start doing this, plus all the kind of influences like Kraftwerk in there with World in My Eyes, for example. They just make almost a pure electronic album,
yeah,
with this blues element.
Yeah,
all of a sudden they're filling stadiums all over the place. And then I think with Songs of Faith and Devotion, they knew that the tour would be massive. So they had to have an album that would fill huge arenas around the world. But they didn't want to do what they did with Violator. And instead, they... Every time I hear that album, I remember being incredibly surprised when I first heard I Feel You. I thought it was a different band, but it was still absolutely incredible. And that leap from World in My Eyes to I Feel You is massive in terms of sound and the type of song. And there are very, very few bands who could
pull that off.
It's a real testament.
Oh, you froze there for a moment, David. You still with us?
Oh, sorry. I was.
Yeah.
Did I get to? Sorry.
Froze for a second.
Just like.
Yeah, I was just. Well, essentially, I think it was a brave move, but a move that really, really worked. And there are not many other bands that could pull that off.
Yeah. Yeah. Mike, you think, saying something? Go.
Yeah. So I think there's a couple things. I agree with everything David said. On top of that, the formula for the album, for both albums, was they follow a very similar arc as far as the progression of the songs through side A, through side B. And I think that's a lot to do with Alan and Flood kind of both still, you know, still driving that. The other thing that sort of comes to mind is that Depeche Mode is always aware of what's going on around them.
Yes.
And, you know, in 1992, when they would have been working on what they're going to do, you know, they're well aware of, you know, of course, Dave was living in LA and we all know that story, but, you know, they're all well aware of what's going on kind of culturally, musically. And I think it was a natural progression of the times. You know, in 1990 when Violator came out, you know, it was raves and techno and all that was huge, and you see that reflected in some of the songs, some of the sounds, some of the remixes. And so I think it was. I think it was. Yes, it was very different, but I don't know that I would say it was completely unexpected, at least for me.
I don't think
that album would have, I don't think the band would have continued on if that had not happened. I don't think Dave, after his influences, like he was listening to Rage Against the Machine and Jane's Addiction, excuse me, and living in LA, doing the rock and roll lifestyle. And I don't think the band would have continued if they didn't appease him somehow and incorporate some sort of a rock element into, you know, I don't know. I mean, for sure, I know they're aware of their circumstances, but you also have to think about that they were filming or recording in Spain. So they're kind of a little detached from the whole grunge thing that's blowing up in America. But I think it's a lot because of those influences that Dave was already listening to that kind of fueled that whole drive for the rock and roll sound.
It's what they brought into the studio with them rather than being influenced while they were in the studio.
And you can still hear a little bit of the overlap between the albums. Like you hear that guitar riff in Policy of Truth from Violator. You hear those things, and then introducing Songs of Faith and Devotion with I Feel You, like da 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 da. It's not like, oh my god, what is this, because we've already heard a little of that of creeping in. It's nice in that way. It's not like what's this. The way I feel like that's the way like people thought about Mandrill is like, because that's completely different, it's not in that way, you know. There's an overlap.
Now also, when I interviewed when I interviewed Dave Bascom, he actually said he felt that Music for the Masses was a precursor to Songs of Faith and Devotion. And if you think about that, think of Music for the Masses and then think of Songs of Faith and Devotion. They're actually more closely related, because Violator sits in the middle of those two, and it's this really minimalistic techno type record. Because, okay, forgive me, not techno, but you know what I mean. It's Music for the Masses is very sort of filmic, lots of layers, very sort of like epic filmic kind of sound. And then when we go to Violator, it's really sort of minimalist. Okay, and I've talked about, and as I'm going to talk in my Violator album review series, on first listen it is kind of minimalist, but when you take those sounds apart, there's lots of layers to those parts. But it is, and in Dave's words in one of the documentaries, were when they made Violator, he said we wanted something more direct and clean and less cluttered. Okay, I don't think he used the right words there, because I don't think Music for the Masses was cluttered, but it was, Violator was indeed a very round, clean, open sound. But if you listen to the sonic qualities as a whole of Songs of Faith and Devotion, it's obviously very gritty, you know, edgy and a rough edge. And as Dave Bascom said, he would like to think he introduced the band to the idea of feedback, you know, like those guitar, that kind of stuff, which is, anyway, take Violator out the mix. Songs of Faith and Devotion does follow on nicely directly from Music for the Masses, I think.
I personally, I would debate that and say Music for the Masses plus Violator equals Songs of Faith and Devotion.
Okay. Diplomatic answer. I can see where you're coming from. Yeah.
I agree with that. I think Music for the Masses is a very European album. It's got a very European feel to it. It's got the Anton videos, which have this kind of dark European film, black and white film feel to it. And they became inadvertent stadium stars as a consequence of Music for the Masses, to then turn them into global superstars. And I think without having those two together, you wouldn't get Songs of Faith and Devotion. So I side with Mike in this one, I think.
Okay, now that's I see where you're going. I mean, obviously it was a stepping stone onto that, but interesting to see the change of direction was so dramatic between, you know, those albums. They really surprised people. I haven't really listened to the last three albums in the kind of detail I've listened, you know, obviously I grew up with the other ones. But Rob, this is something that I think you'd be good to ask on this. You really like the Delta Machine album. How do you think the Delta Machine album is different to sort of the Spirit album? A lot of people are saying that Delta Machine was kind of like a sort of I've just got my wine being topped up here. Excuse me, sorry. Thank you. Service. How do you think Delta Machine compares to Spirit? Thank you very much. Cheers. Cheers, guys. So far as approach goes, I'm not asking how much, you know, which one you preferred more. It's just that a lot of people, a lot of fans were saying that to them, Delta Machine was kind of like paying homage to their roots, and it was kind of like a paying homage to Violator. How do you feel about that?
Well, I was actually going to mention that after our discussion about Music for the Masses and Violator, because I feel like Violator has, even though it's more minimalistic, it has like a fuller, richer sound.
Yes.
I feel like Delta Machine has that fuller, richer sound in comparison to more of a minimalistic Spirit, as opposed to similar to Music for the Masses.
Yes.
the point that I'll make about Delta Machine is, that's the first album where I was actually surprised to be blown away by Dave Gahan's songwriting, where some of my favorite songs from that album were actually written by Dave, which, you know, that was a shocker to me. I did not expect that, because I absolutely respect what Martin's done and what he continues to do. And yes, So to have like so many great tracks penned by Dave was a real surprise to me.
I'm just sorry, and as I say, you know, this is sacrilege. I haven't really paid attention to which songs were written by who on this, really. Which were Dave's songs? And yeah, go on, let's put you to the test.
So the ones that really impressed me were Broken, Secret to the End, and Should Be Higher. Those are the ones that all were written by Dave. So
Should Be Higher was Dave. And you know, Dave always wanted to write. He's obviously got more. I loved Nothing's Impossible was one of my favorite ones. He's obviously getting more songs onto the records now. I don't know how true it was. Apparently there was a bit of friction between Dave and Martin about Dave wanting to put more songs on, to which Fletch had to come in and be the mediator. Is that true or is that just a rumor?
I believe that's true, actually.
Yeah. I think that as well. And like, you know, people I've spoken to would say, oh, it can't be true because Martin's such a humble guy. He's got no ego. And I'm thinking, well, no, I think there must be a little bit of an ego there. I mean, you cannot get to that level and you know, there has to be an ego there. It's not a sort of like a hip hop type ego, you know, it's kind of like a confidence that, look, I've written the albums. I know what's best for this band, really. And I think that's probably where the friction came in.
Like quality bar ego.
Yeah, this is what I mean. I don't think ego is the right word. It's almost like it's kind of like, come on, guys, I've got this, and you know I've got this kind of thing. You can have a go at it, but not in this. It's almost like the way I see it is, as I said, when I first heard the new Martin Gore record and I heard it was instrumental, first I thought, oh, no, it's an instrumental. Okay, I listened to it. I actually liked it, but I've explained why I wanted the vocals. But I think there's a little unwritten kind of law there, unwritten, where it's like kind of like, and Gareth, I was talking to him about this as well yesterday. It was kind of like, now, when we do songs, it's for Depeche Mode. And when it's solo, it's instrumental. But then I said to Gareth, well, at the end of the day, Dave does his own solo records and writes songs. You know, I still, when I see Martin Gore one day, I'm going to say, Martin, loved Counterfeit 2, but I still want you to do a solo record where you're singing on it, because you haven't done that yet. And I think we may get that one day. Who knows?
Yeah, back to the point about Dave's songwriting. Excuse me. Yeah. I think him working with Soul Savers actually helped him evolve his songwriting considerably.
Yeah. It's an outlet for him, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, Atusa, did you want to comment on that?
On Dave's songwriting?
Yeah, Dave, as I said, Martin, I think, has got this thing where he's not going to, any songs that he writes are going to be for Depeche Mode, and any solo work is going to be instrumental.
Well, it's tough. I'm in a band myself, and all the work we have leading up to today all has our feel. You can tell it's us. And recently, our guitar player said that he wanted to write a song, and it's very, very similar in that way. He likes rock music, and we're an electronic rock band. And you still want to let them do it because they're part of the team. And so yeah. I always relate that to Martin and Dave. Like, you want to let them do it, but you don't want it to leave your vision. You want to make sure that you're still Depeche Mode. So it's really hard to let that go. But I think they did a spectacular job. Should Be Higher is one of my favorites off that album. And I was really, really shocked when I read and found out that it was Dave. But it sits in it really, really well. It's beautiful.
It does. Yeah. David, do you want to say anything about that?
Yeah. I think firstly, in relation to Martin releasing an album of his own songs as a solo effort, I don't think we'll see that until Depeche Mode finish, whenever that may be, because...
You're probably right, yes.
His songwriting's so inextricably linked to it,
yeah,
that he has to write as Martin of Depeche Mode rather than Martin the solo artist.
Yeah.
Dave's solo work's a funny one. I find with Dave's solo albums, I must confess, and I'll get drummed out of all the Depeche Mode fan groups here, but I'm not a huge fan of them. I like Kingdom's a good song, and I think Saw Something's a good song until that quite horrific guitar solo lands about 3 minutes in. Dave's songwriting on the albums, I think it seems to vary from album to album. I like Nothing's Impossible. I think that's a fantastic song. But I think I Want It All, which precedes it, is really quite boring, and it was a very boring part of the concerts on that tour. His songwriting's improving, there's no doubt, and the work with Soul Savers has really helped him develop that. But I still think you see quite a difference in quality between the two, which I guess is only natural, because Martin's been doing this for 2 years, and Dave's a relative newcomer. It's good to have Dave involved, though. It's good for him, and I think it's good for everybody. I don't know if Martin would be capable of putting together a full Depeche Mode album anymore without Dave chipping in a song or two just to mix it up a little bit more than anything else.
Yeah, that's true. I think Martin said, as a songwriter, it's very important that you learn to edit yourself, because you know, you write a lot of songs, then it's trying to decide, you know, which goes on and which doesn't, you know. And of course, when you're in the studio, you lose perspective as to, you know, what's good when you're working on something over and over. But let's talk about, Rob, I want to throw this at you. We talk about the sonic, Rob and I've often talked about, you know, the sonic characteristics of a record. Every record intentionally has a different sonic sound. But despite the fact that each record has a different approach, you will find that the as we call the Berlin trilogy, the Gareth Jones records, although there is a different approach, they have a fundamental global sound where they sound the same global, you know, like a global sound, if you know what I mean. Whereas then when we get to Music for the Masses, it's a fundamentally different sound, a very Tears for Fears kind of sound, obviously same producer. I guess what I'm saying is, if we take a song like Rob has said, Blue Dress, not Blue Dress, New Dress. Rob, you go on, say what you said. You said it's doesn't really fit in with the Black Celebration album, not sonically, and it doesn't sound as sophisticated. Or what did you say? The production's not as...
So I feel like Black Celebration, which is my favorite album, I feel like it's timeless, except for the fact that New Dress is included on there.
It's like a B-side, New Dress, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah. The synth drum sound that they're using actually sounds very 80s, whereas the rest of the album, the production, even though they're using synthesizers and samplers from the 80s,
yeah, yeah,
they sound timeless, but timeless, you still hear that, like, that little dee, dee, you know, and it sounds very 80s. And then, of course, the lyrical references are dated as well. I mean, even though the point of the song is timeless, by including Princess Di as the headline, you're dating that to a specific period, whereas the rest of the album is completely timeless. So I had suggested in some conversations that But Not Tonight actually could have replaced that song, and that song is more timeless sounding than New Dress, in my opinion. But
I think,
I know that's not one of the band's favorite songs, but
yeah. Well, I think, you know, I think not. I've got strange taste in music. That's probably why I like Depeche Mode, like you guys. But Not Tonight, I always loved that song. And when I saw documentaries of the band, like especially Alan, like dropping his head in horror, saying, "Yes, well, you know, when they, you know, the story, it was released. Stripped was meant to be the single, but they went, no, this is America. We've got to release Not Tonight." I mean, I personally like Not Tonight quite a lot. In fact, I'm with you, Rob. I like it more than I like a new dress. That's the next thing I want to come on to is B-sides in a moment. You know, a song like Not Tonight, and you know, you take a song like Stripped. Can you guys, and this is not a trick question, could you guys at the time hear that Stripped was a better song than Not Tonight? You know, when you heard it as a younger person, you can now. Yeah. Could you? Yeah.
Absolutely. I knew why they did it in America, but I still felt that Stripped was a better song. I mean, I think the band doesn't like But Not Tonight for the same reason they don't like It's Called the Heart. They feel like they had the wrong single.
Yeah.
You know, the Fly on the Windscreen should have been the single instead of It's Called the Heart.
Yeah.
And But Not Tonight, I don't think they were happy that they let their record company dictate that to them in the U.S.
Yeah. Anyone else want to say anything about that?
I think that it's obviously that's just a personal opinion, but Stripped to me is obviously the far superior song,
yeah.
Just in every aspect. I think But Not Tonight works as a B-side, certainly, because it sounds a bit like a B-side, really. As Rob says, the band were pushed by the record company because it tied into a film that was on the soundtrack for.
Yeah.
It's a good song. I remember when I first heard Stripped, I bought the 12-inch single. And I heard But Not Tonight and I loved it because it's a good pop song. I don't know the fitted in Black Celebration because I think it's too light. My Dress is light as well, but primarily for the reason Rob says, with the lyrical references, because Martin doesn't normally tie his lyrics to any specific time, and mentions of Princess Di and famines and jets being shot from the sky are very, very mid-80s. I think But Not Tonight, Alice, I think its best place was when Martin performs it solo, because that brought me to tears in Dublin in 2000,
yeah.
I think it was. It was a very moving experience, which was fueled by a day filled with Guinness. So it was a good combination.
Well, Dave, let's start with you with this next question now. Without thinking, I want you to blurt out, without thinking, like just straight away, your top three B-sides and go.
B-sides.
Yeah.
Pimp is the first one, because it's just extraordinary. My Joy, B-side of Walking in My Shoes, I think is an incredible song and one that arguably could have been on the album. And Oberkorn is a small town because it's a masterpiece of early 80s experimental electronica that no other band was doing. It may well have been a Daniel Miller and Eric Radcliffe-led project, but it's a gem of a track.
Rob, your top three Depeche Mode B-sides.
Number one, by far, Fly on the Windscreen. Should have been a single. I will say, But Not Tonight is up there. And it's a toss-up between really any of the songs in the Violator era. Dangerous, Sea of Sin, or Happiest Girl could easily be
number one. My Joy, yeah. My Joy. Yeah. Atusa, your top three singles, B-sides?
Dangerous by far is my top one. Gosh, Fly on the Windscreen. I hate saying it because it's from the same era, but Sea of Sin as well.
Yeah, no, that's fine. Mike?
In order, But Not Tonight, Dangerous, and Happiest Girl.
Okay, right. So we're on the quick fire round now. Going back to David. David, without thinking, favorite album and least favorite album? Personal.
Favorite album is Violator, purely because it changed my life. And also, as a promotional thing, I have a book coming out about Violator next year as well, but more about that another time.
No. After this video, we're going to get some details. Absolutely, go on.
Least favorite album? Sounds of the Universe. Good Lord. That's a drag, that album.
Yeah, I think in the words of Simon Forsyth, my grumpy buddy, love him, he said that Sounds of the Universe is the coldest sounding, because there was a real sort of, the whole, when Martin was writing, the whole thing was Martin's buying a lot of analog equipment, and that was kind of like the thing. But as Simon said, it is such a cold sounding record, despite the fact that it is all analog and stuff. But anyway, okay, so you said your top one was Violator and your least favorite was Sounds of the Universe. Rob, over to you, sir.
Black Celebration is my favorite and Speak and Spell is my least favorite.
Okay. Atusa?
Violator is my absolute favorite and the latest spirit, least favorite.
Yeah, I was also quite disappointed with Spirit. Mike, you?
Same as Atusa, Violator and Spirit.
Violator and Spirit, yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, it's interesting because I always talk about the Depeche Mode being an institution. and not a band. And it's fascinating that a band that's been going this long has got this many fans. And what I found is in my group, and Rob, you probably found this in your group as well, is people can agree on so much, but they can disagree on so much as well. And that is what is so, I've not found that with other bands, you know, where there's so much, you know, with other bands, there's usually unanimous agreement. Whereas in Depeche Mode, there are so many, you know, I mean, there are people in my group that think Songs of Faith and Devotion is abysmal. And I just don't get that. But people have all got their own opinions. I'm losing my train of thought now. Go on, Rob, you're going to say something while I'm kicking in.
Oh, no, I wasn't planning to say anything at all. I was just agreeing with what you were saying. And I was surprised that the Songs of Faith and Devotion.
Yeah. I was also shocked when I've had people say, when quite a few, they say when Songs of Faith and Devotion came, they went, I'm not having this. And they just kind of turned their back into Depeche Mode. I was just like, okay, I think I loved Songs of Faith and Devotion. I think it was one of my all time favorites. Yeah.
I had received someone made a copy of it on cassette like 10 days before it was released. I think you received an advanced copy too, didn't you, Mike? Songs of Faith and Devotion? Yeah.
Yep.
So we had the album before it came out, but back then it was not the internet. You had like cassette tapes or whatever, but, and I remember hearing it on headphones for the first time and I was floored when I heard it. I thought it was amazing and I still think it's amazing. It definitely took it to that next step. Oh, nice.
Oh, Mike's trying to go it up the ante there.
He's upping the ante over there.
By the way, to you guys watching this, make sure you subscribe to Depeche Mode Global. Rob here he runs it. He does a fantastic job. And the reason I call him up the ante Rob is because he just has this habit, not in an arrogant way, of when you say something, he's done it better. So I met Martin Gore. And he's like, yeah, well, I hung out with Martin Gore and he bought me a beer. So that is why we call him up the ante Rob. So it's all in good faith. Guys, I did a video on my channel once called Depeche Mode, the Producers. And it's always fascinated me that they would stick with Gareth for 3 records. And then it was kind of like just 1 record with Bascombe. And then Flood 2 records. I was surprised that they stayed with Ben Hillier for 3 records. Now, that's no disrespect to Ben, but Ben Hillier is the producer that gets... Okay, when I put that video up about the Depeche Mode producers, I was just mentioning who the producers were. And as human nature goes, people always want to turn it into a contest. They always want to go, I prefer bananas to apples. I kind of like oranges, but I'm a banana kind of guy. You know, they always want to compare things. And Ben Hillier came kind of, and you know, just came up as the least popular producer. And the favorites were Flood and Jones. But I think I would like to have seen, here's the question here. A guy who went on to run a meatball shop in Prague, which I thought was such a waste of talent. Tim Simonen did a fantastic job on Ultra. The question to you guys is, would you have liked to have seen Tim Simonen? What did you think of Ultra? And do you think you would like to have seen Tim do another album? Rob, while I've got you there.
Oh, Ultra is phenomenal. And we've had discussions about how amazing it is to come in that aftermath of Alan departing and just, you know, pretty much Martin did that all on his own, really, yes. If you think about it, because Dave was still like recuperating from getting sober and Fletch was there to clap, I guess, but yeah, so it's a phenomenal album, and for sure Tim Simonen did such a great job there. I would not be opposed to hearing him on another album.
Mike, same question to you.
Yeah, for the most part the same. I feel like with Tim Simonen comes the other Bomb the Bass crew, and
yes,
you know, I would have to wonder if it was just him or if it was kind of that whole crew. Granted, you know, even Ben Hillier has a whole crew of folks. You know, it's not just him and Martin and Dave sitting in a room. You know, there's a whole gaggle of people doing stuff, and but yeah, I would. It would have been interesting, you know, just thinking about what Exciter would have been if Tim would have stuck around, or you know, they picked him again, however, whatever the case is.
Yeah, sure. Atusa?
I loved Ultra. I thought it was great, but I'm one of those people who, I love each album and each producer's works for what it is. A lot of people didn't like Exciter, and a lot of people did say, what if they had somebody else do it? But yeah. I personally liked it very much. There are certain aspects and sonics of it that really, really impress me and just stick with me and remind me of certain times in my life. And I couldn't say I wish this person was doing this, because I think everything that they've done is just perfect the way that it is, even if there's songs that I don't like.
Yeah. So. Oh, great. Yes, Dave?
I love Ultra. I think it's fantastic. It's very much the sound of a hangover after a party, which is, of course, what they were suffering at the time. I think Exciter works because of Mark Bell's production, because of the low-key electronic aspects of it. I don't think Tim's production would necessarily have married up with the feel of the songs in Exciter, because if you look at Ultra, it's quite bombastic in places, very dark. I think...
Go on, Dave, go on.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I just think it's interesting. They had two different producers for two different albums there, and both albums are entirely different. Mm-hmm. I think that keeps things fresh. I think three albums in a row worked in the '80s with Gareth and with Daniel, because they were still experimenting and pushing boundaries there and trying new things. I think the Ben Hillier trilogy kind of ran its course fairly early. I prefer when they mix it up. I'd like to see them doing something really different next time. I don't know, it's a dream to have Trent Reznor doing it, or James Murphy doing it, or something like that. It's something completely different. Because I think when they do bring in different influences, I think it inspires them.
Well, I think you know, and when I did that video, there were certain questions. You know, when James Ford was used. You know, James Ford is a fine producer, but people questioned why him. And I have to say, this goes to me with Depeche Mode's thinking out of the box thing. You wouldn't necessarily ask someone who's a huge fanboy to produce your record. You know, sometimes maybe it's better to ask someone who's not a fan, because they will, you know, bring different elements to it. What do you guys feel about that? Rob?
Well, one other point I was wondering, I mean, I don't know their whole crew, but I know that they've been using like certain guys like Kurt Unella.
Yeah.
And so I wonder, you know, they're coming album together. So I don't know how much of the producer's crew they're using, as opposed to these guys, that these core people that they've worked with before. I don't know. I haven't researched it enough. And I actually would like to get Kurt Unella on a drinking chat at some point. So if you see this video, Kurt, we're coming for you, hopefully.
Yeah, Rob and I are coming for all of you. We're coming for everyone. Anyone else want to comment on that?
Yeah, I could. I mean, Tim Simonon was a pretty big fan when he did it. So I don't think it's out of the question. I think for the most part, it's how well they sort of gel with the person, whether they're a fan of the band or not. It's how can the producer kind of push them and guide them? And I think that's been one of the interesting conundrums with, you know, from Exciter to now, is that they get along. Obviously they got along with Ben, and it would be interesting to bring in, like Tusa said, like Trent or somebody, you know, somebody else that's not necessarily just because of name, but because of what they've done. And what they could collaborate with, I think would be cool.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, I think it's always that. Yeah, that is the question. You know, do you get a fan or do you get someone who's impartial? Who knows?
I almost feel like it's impossible to get not to get somebody who's in electronic music who isn't a fan of Depeche Mode at this point.
Well, this is very true as well. I don't know, and it's like I just feel that I did an interview with Alex Fernandez, who's he's a huge Depeche Mode fan, and he's more of an Alan Wilder fan because he's actually personal friends with Alan Wilder. He was very, 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 very disappointed with Spirit. But from what he explained to me, I get this feeling that the band, look, okay, first things first, they've got nothing to prove. Nothing to prove. Done their time. Martin will come with a demo. And I just get the idea that Martin will present the demo to the producer. And then they've got these huge production teams, like maybe 4 or 5 people working on this. I just feel that in the earlier days, it was just the band. It was just Alan and just Martin and the producer. And they had a more hands-on thing. Whereas I get the feeling, and I could be wrong, I get the feeling that Martin will present the demo and then they've got a programmer there. He'll have a go at it. That guy will have a go at it. And there's just, and these are fine programmers. But it's just that I just feel that the band don't have they don't have as much hands-on control of the stuff. Now, of course, they have the final say. If they don't like something, of course, so they are like the be-all and end-all. But I just think they are not as hands-on as they used to be. Am I right? Do you guys think that as well?
Well, especially if you look at their mixes, their remixes of their songs, when they were involved in the 80s, all those iconic mixes were, the band were involved in most of those. Whereas now you get all these things that are just like, a complete departure from the song, and it's just like a drum beat with the vocals overlaid or whatever, and a bunch of techno stuff going on in the background.
Dance music,
yeah.
Dave, what do you think? Oh. Sorry, Dave. What do you think? What did you think?
Sorry, I just lost the question there, Vaughn. Sorry, my sound just dropped out there. So what was the question? Sorry.
And I cut a two self. A two self. Come back to you as well now. The question I asked was, what was the question I just asked? God.
Rob, what was the question?
About the programming.
Yes. David, I just feel that the band are sort of less hands on with the production these days. I get the idea that Martin will come in with a demo. And then they've got other producers kind of working hands-on to, you know, produce it. Whereas in the old days, they would be completely hands-on.
Yeah. I think when the band were recording their original albums, shall we see?
No.
Oh, you're sounding like Stephen Hawking there.
David's gone Hawking.
It looks like I think you're having some connection troubles there with David. Don't worry. Okay. Well, we lost him. He'll come. Oh, he's running. Someone chasing you. It's like a zombie movie. Someone's running after him.
He's in the Shake the Disease video.
Let's hope he.
Sorry. Right.
There we go.
I'm back. Sorry.
You're back. I thought something was chasing you.
Sorry about that.
Go on. We like a bit of theatre.
Thank you.
Oh.
Sorry about that.
Yeah, there we go.
Still not going?
Now you're back.
Can you hear me okay?
You're still there. Yeah. Go ahead, David.
You have the mic.
Right.
Did you get the question or no?
Was this about Depeche Mode's quality control in the studio?
Yes, they're not as hands-on. They've got other people doing it for them.
The programmers seem to be doing more of the work these days as opposed to the band as they did in the past.
Yeah. Okay, well, I'll tell you what. I'm going to go on to a Tusa now.
Hold on. Can I jump in on that one real quick?
Yes, you can. Go for it.
Okay, sorry, Tusa. I think I don't think it's any more or less than it was before.
Okay.
We know what Martin does. We know what Dave does. We know what Fletch does. Having three or four people poking around in the studio is a balance for missing Alan Wilder.
Yes.
Cue the horn. That's what I think.
You're right. Absolutely.
That they're missing is, you know, Alan was the one that would sit in there and tinker with the engineers and the producer and so on. And I think Martin does more of that probably now than he did then.
Yeah.
I think the balance is still about the same as it's ever been.
I see what you mean. Yeah.
That's my speculation.
Okay. So what do you think, Atusa?
That's funny. I was going to say exactly that, and I'll
Sorry.
Oh, no, it's okay. What I was going to say. No, I'll reference it back to like the time of Exciter, or even if you put Exciter next to Martin Gore's Counterfeit 2, you can almost like make a playlist of those two albums together, and they kind of go well together because the producers or the tech people that they had on those two, there are a lot of the same people, including that Philpott that I fancied so much. He had a lot of hand in that, and you could hear that quality. And what is that quality? That's the Alan Wilder quality coming in there. Like when I went to that Martin Gore solo show, that's kind of why I fancied Philpott, because he was the Alan Wilder that was missing. You know, he was doing things. Yeah, he was doing those.
Was he the guy sitting on stage behind the laptops and the computers and stuff, kind of? Was that him?
Yes. He was kind of the Alan Wilder back then, really. Yeah. The things that he was doing. And
I do love the sound of, I'm just thinking of one of the most innovative tracks on Counterfeit 2 was the "In My Time of Dying, I Don't Want Nobody to Mourn." I love that it's got this really dry, intimate, no effect. Well, there's got that, and then that doom, doom, doo, 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 doom, doo, doo. It's just that sequence is, okay, I'm getting all fanboy and geeky here, but that sequence, that doom, doom, doo, doo, doom, doom, doo, 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 it's just mad. Absolutely loved it. And I actually found, I was listening to that the other day, and I thought the production on that, it's just knocks a lot of their recent stuff out of the water, you know? And it's like, if we listen to Counterfeit One to me was kind of like, I just, sorry, this is only my little head now. I imagine Martin sitting in a little room with a little tape deck and a little, you know, Porter studio and making this album. And that's what I loved about Counterfeit One. It's got a really honest demo-like sound. But if you listen to Counterfeit 2, it's got a really sophisticated, polished sound, which is a lot better than, I think, the sound of Spirit, if I'm to be brutally honest.
I would agree there.
Bring Philpott back. Bring Philpott back. Yeah?
Andrew Philpott, if you're watching this, come back.
Where is he? What have you done with him?
He's actually done a couple other things after. He was in he made a band called Das Shadow, which was excellent. You guys have to listen to some of the Das Shadow tracks.
Yeah.
And then he created a band called Broadbean Band, and that's excellent as well. Both very electronic, but you can hear how he really influenced songs on Exciter and on Counterfeit 2.
Okay.
Right. You're right, though, Vaughn, you know, Alan's original Recoil work and Martin's original Counterfeit work were... That was just them screwing around in the back of the bus or the plane during the Music for the Masses tour. And that they both decided to put it on tape and put it out.
Yeah.
You know, as you listen to Alan's, you know, Bloodline was the first kind of the first one that came out after that stuff. And then Martin did Counterfeit too. You can see where they both kind of progressed with what they were doing with their side things.
Yeah. Let's actually, this is something you've hit onto there, Mike. Let's talk about the music videos now. Now, video was something they really struggled with early on. It was when they met Anton that they really felt that they had found someone who was not only, well, he started off as a photographer, but he's almost become like a visual director now for them. One of the questions, and a lot of questions, and indeed a lot of the subjects that I talk about on my channel are based on the feedback I get from the community. People will say things and that'll inspire me to make a video. And the question I'm putting out to you guys now is a question that a comment that I've heard from a lot of my subscribers is that they would like to see Depeche Mode, and this is no disrespect to Anton, but they would like to see Depeche Mode using Anton maybe less, or I guess what they're saying is don't use Anton for everything. Use him for your photos, but try someone else for a video. You understand? Because he's doing the videos, he's doing the stage projections and everything. How do you guys feel about that? David?
Oh, I'm sorry about my earlier interruption. First of all, I lost my broadband upstairs. Anton, yeah, I think it's a hard one because you look at Anton's work with the band from, say, 86 to 97, and it's basically perfect.
Yeah.
You know, the artwork Violator is almost as important as the music, which sounds like a preposterous thing to say, but you can't think of Violator without picturing the cover, without right. picturing the videos. You get to now, and it seems the band, to pick up a theme before I dropped out, they're perhaps getting a wee bit lazy in the studio by not having their own internal quality control with the music. And it seems that the minute they decide they're doing a new project, everything's passed off to Anton
yeah.
on the art thing, which is why you end up seeing Enjoy the Silence live with a massive rabbit or a chicken.
Yeah, what was that? What was that about? I'm like, come on, you know.
Yeah, it's...
They would have been better off just using the video, you know, the actual footage from the video.
I would during the first show on the last tour in Stockholm, I was tweeting pictures of it live, and I tweeted a picture of Dave during Enjoy the Silence with the big chicken behind him and said Dave Gann's got his cock with him on stage. It was wildly misinterpreted by many hundreds of people. I think they need to change, basically. I think keep Anton to the artwork.
Yeah.
Try something different. I think there's no harm in trying something different.
Yeah, absolutely. Rom, what do you think?
I actually don't think they should keep him for the artwork either. I think just as a photographer, it seems like he's kind of gotten a bit, I don't know whether complacent or just trying to be minimalistic or just, I don't know. I mean, I've done a lot of graphic design stuff myself and
yeah.
you know, spirit and sounds of the universe. And I mean, if you look at the Mandrill single cover, it's kind of more visually appealing than those particular record covers. And that was done by a monkey. So I love his photography. I feel like he's definitely an iconic photographer. Video wise, over the years, it's been hit or miss. You know, I liked what he did on Strange One and Strange Two, but I don't know that I'm so big on, like, even though it became an iconic visual, the whole crown and the cape and thing walking around in the snow, like, it just, I mean, it ended up representing that song, but not in a way that I would have portrayed or thought that should have been portrayed. But I mean, when you talk about videos, some of my favorites, like we've had Peter Kerr on Stripped and Shake the Disease. Like, I felt like those represented the band in a dark way that fit with the music.
And even Brian Griffin's Only When I Lose Myself, that was a very good video as well, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was a good video. And to your point about bringing in new people, like, they have new ideas and new passions. So, like, I'm sure the people that did, whoever did the video for Wrong, I don't even know who did it, but
that was great. That was amazing. Very
creative and innovative, and you bring in some new blood like that and they're going to come up with great ideas. Another standout video that is from the Songs of Faith and Devotion period, One Caress Was Not Done by Anton, and that I think that's a pretty good video actually. For sure, I have respect for Anton, but I'm more of a fan of his photography than of what he's done, like, with the covers. And I mean, of course, he's done some of the iconic images, like you said, Violator. For sure, that's iconic. But it's definitely time to move on.
Correct, correct. I wonder who actually did the actual artwork for Violator. That'll be interesting too, because that's obviously Anton's idea, but someone actually, there was obviously an artist who actually did that, and I wonder who it was. That'd be interesting too. Rob, that's our next one to headhunt. Rob, I tell you what, you and I should actually do a photo of ourselves with like kind of like war paint and go, the headhunters. Yeah, we're going to headhunt you. And we'll give all their heads to, was it Jessica, the headhunter girl?
Oh, yeah.
Atusa, what do you think? Are they using Anton for too many things?
Absolutely. Yeah. I will say that when I was a kid, I used to come home from school and pop in the Strange 2 VHS almost every day. I would watch that video to bits. I remember listening to Violator and thinking, oh, I wonder what the Halo video is going to be. You are guilt like shackles on your feet. This is going to be dark. And then it's like Martin juggling in a clown costume.
Yeah.
And it left you going, what? But I love it. It's great. But as the years go on, that kind of starts getting old, like the chickens and the bunnies. And it's time to move on. Absolutely.
But Atusa, on that, what did you think? I just thought... at the time when I saw it, I just thought, God, this is low budget and cheap. But I was younger, I didn't know. But if I think of it now, how brilliant is the music video to Clean?
As Martin said,
it was one of the easiest videos I ever did. I just had to kiss a girl.
Yeah, because that's all it was. But how effective is it? And you look at it, you know, it's almost got this really like, sort of like blue movie, say blue movie, as a pornographic kind of thing. You know, it's kind of like, you know, just like this swimming pool and this woman walking in and they're just watching I'm actually getting goose flesh as I say, because it's just got this, it is so, Vaughn, you pervert, Martin, the kinky bastard. No, but it's just got such a powerful, you know, because if you think of the song, Clean, the cleanest I've been, you would conjure up certain images as to what that music video would look like. But then for him to just say, okay, you're just going to kiss this girl while they're watching it, it's absolutely brilliant. And then at the end, they get up and they walk away, and then the camera keeps focusing on the projections. It's absolutely brilliant. I thought it was very arty-farty at the time, you know, when I was younger, but I'm looking at it now and I'm just going, wow, what a video. And so low budget and simple.
And the irony there is they're watching the live projection from the Violator tour that Anton did.
Yeah.
I've interviewed the actress who's in the video for the book, and she was a huge Depeche Mode fan, and Martin was her favourite band member, so when she got this job, she was delighted.
The girl he was kissing in the video?
Yeah, Angela Sheldon is her name. And so I've spoken to her about it. So I've had a good chat to her about the video and what she did all day, which was basically getting off with or making out with, Martin Gore.
Wonderful.
All day. So she had a wonderful day. It's one of the best jobs she ever had. So.
Well, I'll tell you what, this is interesting. Would she be interesting to come on for a chat on this group?
Maybe, yeah. I'm still in touch with her about the book, so I can find out.
Absolutely. Now that's great. And I tell you what, I think what we're going to do is, guys, we're going to, as I'm looking at you all now, I have these memories of these drink and chats that go on all night, but this is a video that's going to go onto YouTube. And I just wanted to sort of, as I say, do a video as part of my 40 years of Depeche Mode series and just talk to a few fans who are very interesting to talk to. And indeed you all are. But this is just the beginning. We're going to do, I'd like to do some more. And to you guys watching, I would like you all to go on to Facebook. You've all got a Facebook group you've all got a Facebook page, more than a billion users. And you are all to join Rob Rom's Depeche Mode Global Facebook group. It is the hub and the central point for anyone who's a Depeche Mode fan, besides my group, of course. But yeah, Rob Rom. And then also, Rob, if there's anything else you'd like to say about your group or what you guys are doing in the next few weeks or...
Well, we do have a drink and chat scheduled for this Saturday, I guess tomorrow at 6 o'clock Pacific time. But I don't know, it'll probably be too late for, I'm not sure when you're posting the video, but we usually have something going on every week. I'm trying to plan something for next week, Friday, actually, so... That's a holiday here in the U.S., and it would it would actually coincide with timing wise for you in the UK as well, because I would probably start something at 1 o'clock on Friday. So hopefully you guys can join us next week.
Yeah, guys. So check out Rob Brom's group. It's Depeche Mode Global. Just go into Facebook and type in Depeche Mode Global. Really great group. And yeah, it's a busy day for you tomorrow, Rob. Rob is going to be co-host for me with the Gary Newman. And then afterwards, because you're starting at 6 p.m., which is 2 o'clock in the morning here. So when I wake up in the morning, you'll probably still be going. So I'll probably jump onto that call there. And it's always a lot of fun. So yeah, Rob, awesome, absolutely awesome group. Atusa, tell us more about your band.
Oh, my band.
Yes. And where can we hear the music? And by the way, I'm going to put links in the description below, guys. You can check it out.
We are on iTunes. We're called Former Human Beings. We have covered a Depeche Mode song, but that's not on iTunes. It's you can find it on my SoundCloud. But yeah, we're an electronic rock band. We really like Depeche Mode. And one of the best things I've ever heard coming off the stage one day was, I've never heard of you guys. I was just in the venue, and you guys sound like, I don't know if you've heard them before, but you sound like Depeche Mode. And I just, my work here is done. So.
No, check it out. As I say, guys, I'll put links in the description below, and you will check out the charismatic Atusa and her rock band. I call her Alpha Rock Chick. Mike, any links you want to share? You're a producer. Anything you're up to at the moment? Anything you want to share?
Well, I have I tinker with covering Depeche Mode, recreating/remixing, covering, call it whatever you want, Depeche Mode songs, and I've got those on SoundCloud. I think my handle is Black Celebration Tonight, which is also where I'm at on Twitter. Yeah. Although the at handle on Twitter is Black_Tonight. Mm. But I'm always chatting, you know, with David and Rob and other folks all over the place on Twitter. And I've been doing a thing on Twitter called Saturday Morning Vinyl, where I get on and I go through the collection and just put on whatever comes to mind and then post a picture of it, and folks follow along in their heads, I guess. So that's been fun. Yeah, just I'm on the drinking chat every week with Rob, and
any excuse to drink, hey? David, as I say, I've met you for the first time today. But David, when Rob mentioned you and he said David McElroy, almost predictable blog, I knew it, and it's kind of like forgive me if I'm not paying attention, but I've obviously come across it somewhere. But tell us, you're obviously writing a book. Tell us what you're up to and where we can find you.
Yeah, well, the blog is called Almost Predictable Almost, and it's on, there's a Facebook page for it, and there's the actual blog itself, which is almostpredictablealmostblogspot.com. Essentially, it's just lots of things about Depeche Mode. I'm currently undertaking a project where I review every single they've ever written. Which is one of these things I do that seemed like a good idea at the time, and then you realize they've released about 50 singles and I'm only at number 4. But it's quite good fun. I did a thing for the Global Spirit Tour, which Rob kindly helped out with, where I reviewed every gig on the tour. Okay. A fan that was there wrote a review, and Rob was one of them. So I try and do lots of different things to keep it interesting. I'm also co-authoring a book about Violator called Halo, which is out next year. Kevin May, the author, asked me to join in. Last year, so I've been helping out Kevin. We've been interviewing quite a few people, such as Angela Sheldon, who I mentioned. I've interviewed Billy Ray Martin from Electribe 101 about the rough time they had supporting Depeche Mode in Europe, because Depeche Mode's European fan base are not friendly to support bands. Like Mike says, you can find me on Twitter as well, where I'm usually doing what Mike does and showing pictures of records and just generally being fairly boring about Depeche Mode.
Well, you are one of the tribe, and you're doing good work in the institution of Depeche Mode. So please keep in touch, obviously. And you know, when the book comes out, I will obviously share the links on my social media and everything.
Thank you.
So
could I quickly plug David's month-long Violator blog thing? Just talk about that for a second, because that was awesome.
Yeah, well, for the 30th anniversary, I decided to celebrate Violator by hosting a Violator month, which again is one of these ideas I have at 2 o'clock in the morning that I write down, then say I'm going to do out loud, and then have to do. It was a post every day in March, looking at the album in different ways. Mike contributed to that with a piece about the warehouse riot, and I managed to fill 31 days with some guest contributions. Lots of different chat about the singles and the albums. I did a similar one for Black Celebration in 2016 and interviewed Gareth for that as well. Gareth was very, very kindly gave me a couple of hours of his time to listen to my inane questions about Black Celebration. So, yeah, the Violator month was a big success. It was good fun. All the posts are still there on the blog, so everybody can go and enjoy them or criticise them anytime they wish. But it's I'm glad Mike enjoyed it, and I got a lot of positive feedback about it. Because I think, as we all know, there is still this gargantuan appetite for Depeche Mode. So it's always nice to be able to talk about it.
Yeah. I just find as they get older, and there seems to be this real sort of like awakening with people, where people are really sort of conscious of the fact that these people are the guys who really started it, you know, that generation. And they're not going to be around for longer, not meaning they're going to die. But, you know, we as humans have a period as for what, you know, anyway, I don't need to describe that. But and just picking up on something you said there, David, when you said how you decided you were going to do that, and then you realized, oh, my God, what a huge task. It's a bit like my album review series where I went, I'm going to review every Depeche Mode album. It's like, okay, my God. My channel, I learned today, is about 2 years old now, and we're only starting in Violator. And on that Violator album review series, which is going to start next year, we're going to go into a lot of depth. It's going to be one episode per track. And David, I'd probably like to get you on a separate episode, because you've obviously got expertise on that subject.
Can I get one more plug in? I forgot to mention my radio show Mode Block.
Yes. Oh, yes.
So I had the 20th episode this last Monday. And it's an hour-long Depeche Mode radio show. You can hear it anywhere in the world on the internet. And the archives are available at the same place where you can hear new episodes. The new episodes air Monday, 8 p.m. Pacific time. And you can go to the Reflex with two X's, thereflex.com/reflexradio. And that's where you can listen to it. There's also a Mode Block Facebook page. So just want to put that out there. You're welcome to come listen. I think you'll enjoy it if you get a chance. So thank you.
So Rob, absolutely. So it's Reflex with two XX. So it's XX, not triple X rated.
Yes, it's only double X. Yeah. So the Reflex is actually a great band here in Southern California. They're like a 80s new wave band. And they perform like all over the world as well. But they're a great band. And the guy Greg Craycraft has created this radio station, which you can listen to the radio station all day long, and they play great music all the time. So it's something, definitely check it out.
Well, that's great. Well, I'm certainly looking forward to coming to California. Anyone comes down to London, guys, my door's wide open. Yeah. Atusa, there's a Uber cab waiting for you at the end. I won't go into the detail. David, if you want to come out of you're the closest, you want to get out of the smoke and gloom and the bad weather there in Scotland, mate, come and hang out with me. Are you more than welcome? Yeah, all right. Yeah, we won't go into that.
Yep. Same for anyone. And if anyone is ever brave enough to come to Glasgow, come and look me up. We'll go out for a drink and we'll have a good chat about Depeche Mode.
Listen, Mike, Atusa, Rob, David, it's been an absolute blast. I feel I want to go on all night. Maybe we could hang up and just carry on. Maybe we could hang up and carry on. So I think we might do that, actually. So we're going to say goodbye, and then we're going to just continue after this. So, guys, thank you very much. All the links in the description below. Once again, my big thanks to Mike, Atusa, Rob, and David. Fantastic, just decent humans, like most Depeche Mode fans I've met. I think we should do a video. What is it about the fans? Just really great people. Anyway, guys, lots of love to you. We're going to hang up, and then we're going to go into our own little mini drink and chat here. Thank you, guys. See you on the next one.
Bye.
Adios. Bye.